In this video, I'm going to tell you my story of seeing the real face of poverty alleviation in China.
不是说国家是二零二零年，不是说你们绝对脱贫了，你同意吗？
那是什么叫做叫口号，知道吗？
有些人是好吃懒做，什么都想依靠国家来跟他扶贫，知道不？叫穷啊，叫国家给他补贴什么？说我最恨这种男人，我们这小区多得很。如果你在这里活不下去，你为什么不申请退房？退房你就回去啊，回去干你的农活。
I'm also gonna say something that other China vloggers probably wouldn't be bothered to say. You are probably inundated with many similar things. The Chinese government has lifted 800 million people out of poverty, and it is one of the greatest achievements of humanity. Many foreigners came to China and were absolutely blown away by China's beautiful, cutting-edge infrastructure. But having traveled to enough Chinese villages, I know from experience that poverty is still something very relevant in China. Being poor in China is something that's much different from what you see as a tourist. Although Beijing has claimed that people being lifted out of poverty no longer have to worry about food and clothing, and they all have access to safe housing, healthcare, and education. How much of this work has truly been effective and made people happier and more capable of a productive life? Join me on my trip in Guizhou, one of China's poorest regions, to connect with the reality. I spent most of my time in a fourth-tier city called Tongren, which locates at the border of Guizhou, Hunan, and Chongqing. Historically, Guizhou struggled with poverty because of its difficult geographical location that sits at the heart of the Tibet-Guizhou Plateau, China's most rugged and landlocked interior. Even after China began modernity in 1978, generations scattered in seclusion had much less access to technology, new information, and higher education. It made it extremely hard for a place like Guizhou to innovate, attract investment, and develop quickly like its southeastern counterpart. As a part of the targeted poverty alleviation campaign, the authority has built some of the largest relocation communities in Guizhou, intended to move nearly 2 million people from remote villages to live in the city.
I am currently in one of the biggest relocation communities in the Tongren city, which holds roughly 4,000 families. That is about 1,800 people originally moving from the remote places in the mountains in Guizhou. Already, I am seeing two kindergartens, one primary school back there, and one high school at the far end of the neighborhood. There is also a health center, a mini factory that is supposed to be giving 400 jobs to the local communities at an average salary of 3,000 RMB per month.
Remember this detail, as later it will be put into test.
There are also many shops and markets built here that are supposed to be meeting the daily needs of the people.
你来，你请吧。
好，
我在老家，上学太麻烦了，所以呢，我们就搬过来了。那你是要走个一个小时还是两个小时路啊？路的话才到街上。
每天走路。
对。
What about the adults? At the beginning, I actually didn't have the best luck approaching the adults.
小美女，我在就是拍一个就是小视频的这个小视频，我不知道我有几个问题，不知道你愿不愿意就是回答一下我。不行吗？哦，好好，谢谢。Well, that's no. but let's find more people. 就是我问几个问题，然后你可以回答一下我。不可以啊？好，没事，谢谢。
So finally, at a local community park, I met a group of Chinese uncles and aunties having an afternoon chat, and they didn't seem to mind my presence. At first, I was just listening because I didn't want to be intrusive. And then I began to ask questions, blending in naturally.
这个地方千多块钱，
一千多块钱。
嗯，对。
不是说有三千块钱？
你谁给我了三千多块钱？
不是有那个微工厂吗？
你去问一下，有三千多吗？有三千多，我们全部去了。有三千多，有个鬼呀！他们就骗人了。
真的？
真的都是千多块，
最多块钱，
最多一千八了不起了。
没有，
而且工资还几个月不发，没有了。
不发？
那是。
为什么会没有呢？
没有那么多就没有那么多，他也不保底。 说得好听的骗人的，骗政府的钱。我跟你说，他们那个微工厂，国政府还补助他们的钱。
哦，政府还补助那么多钱？那是老板不按时发工资。
是啊，就搞建筑的有些工资几年了都不给的，几年了不给。就包括这个29小这个学校，现在都在拖欠人家的工资。
And honestly, I was a bit taken aback by what he said. I guess that's the problem of reading the Chinese national news, because most of the time you get the best case scenario, which is not always the case in the every normal daily life.
我刚开始的啊，老家的人就问我一次，哎呦，你们有生活补助了？你想多了，个精神啊，那个还要给你安排工作，给几个人安排，给几个人安排，你想多了，个精神。
你怎么赚钱了？
哇，我就靠子女了。
他们就相当于每个月给你寄生活费。
对对对，我就是这里玩了，不管了，反正我干不来活了。我一看新闻，中央政策是，你要实际下来不用。我跟你说，假如中央下了1000块钱啊，你到老百姓有没有10块钱？你信吗？啊，我们打个比方啊，我们三个是领导是吧？他是大领导，他给你1000块，你可能给我500块，那放下来，我给他可能就是100块了哦。你要吃，我要吃，他要吃了不？
If you haven't fully understood what the man said, the local government has funded the local businesses, but who failed to provide enough work for the locals and then pay them on time. Some of the public subsidies that were intended to support the locals were diluted and then absorbed by third parties through corruption. But I also thought that people also have influence over their life. So I asked the man.
我就是说你说的欺上瞒下，那为什么你还选择搬过来呢？
这个是当时就是谁挂就是怎么说。
这个谁知道呢？是这样的。谁知道呢？
哦，就当时他是怎么就是说服你来这儿的呀？
就是说什么都有了，就像你刚才说的那样，就差不多就有。
就是养着个
老
行嘛，是不是？
老家的干部说的不一样，在这里呢说的不一样了。老家就是说真的什么都有，你们去吗？啊，这里来哦吼，什么都没有了。你以为？
那有房子呀、啊？
就那个房子呢？
那个房子啊，
就是呢。房子，而且很里面的什么东西都是差的。我们那里面全部什么东西都换完了，要重新买个。我第一次差一点气哭了，真的啊，我真的能是气哭了噶。那个水龙头爆水了，那个水龙头坏了，嘣。全部是水，我差一点气哭了，知道？才来几天我，你以为你试试看了？而且你还自己掏钱去买，啊，就好，那也不管你。
那大叔，那你觉得你自己脱贫了吗？
我觉得我还脱不了贫，因为我还有两个在读书。
不是说国家是2020年，不是说你们绝对脱贫，那你同意吗？
那是什么叫口号，知道吗？懂不懂？就那么回事呢。
As I was listening to him, a lady noticed our conversation, and she seemed to strongly disagree with this man's criticisms.
国定工资是100%没得。
打死人家！
你有国定工资，你就不敢来。
人家有大学出来的，人家。
你要就是没来之前哦，来了之后才有了。
啊，我都谈个哪样啊？
你要是啷个是啷？
我不是他办了之后来的好处吗？
你是他来。
你刚才就没听懂我说的话，他就应该听懂了。我就说
每个人的角度，
每个家庭，每个人的因素不一样，所以说表达的出来的事情跟因素也不一样。
然后这就等于说很方便，
对啊，
就是一件很好的事情。
In the middle of a short silence, she asked me if I'd like to hang out with her at her house. And it didn't take her long to confess to me what she really thought of the Chinese uncle I was previously talking to.
这个房子，
我跟你说啊。有些人是好吃懒做，什么都向一个国家来跟他扶贫，知道不？因为他那个人，我经常在这里就是游玩，什么事都不干，就像一个月叫穷啊，叫国家给他补贴什么生活费。我最恨这种男人，我们这小区多得很，他妈嘴巴就说人家政府不好，什么党不好，什么什么什么。你就算你在老家，在外面打工，在任何地方生活，你是不是靠自己的实质去挣钱，然后靠自己？你去靠国家这么大，国家10多亿，那穷国家的羊，那国家灭亡了哦。 我可以，我不害羞。我就想反过来说，你说你搬到这里，那要么你就去申请退房，那你为什么早不申请呢？你这样、
可以申请退房是吗？
可以，如果你在这活不下去，你为什么不申请退房？退房你就回去啊，回去干你的农活。你在家里也是这样敲着你，谁给你饭吃，是吧？你搬到这里来，不漏雨不吹风是吧？你还埋怨人家国家不给你什么什么的，你就在这里无法生活，是吧？你看你那个样子像无法生活的人吗？
是是是，
所以说这个思维的问题，思想和心态不如你，什么，就算国家什么补你都没用用，国家补你嘛，这个月发600生活给你，你不就做，你600用完了，你还有吗？没有了，是吧？国家政策是好事，就是看你怎么去对待这个问题，在哪个地方，在每个角落，你生活，他是不是对自己双手努力才有进展？那国家再有发财再有钱，给他不可能就为你一个人多发几百块钱嘛，那是统一的嘛。总是想到哦，国家在补贴在管我，我就懒得去住了，反正我是没钱，我就靠你呗，我就问你要呗。你给我弄到这里来，我无法生活，你就管我，你不管我，你现在弄我回去吧。以前那些房子不是拆的东西吗？那你去给我建啊。他就是这种思维，知道吧？所以说我不赞成那个男的说话，所以说我宁愿走了，我都不跟他多讲几句，因为讲到后面，也许就是那病人嘛，说话吵架的后果。我说，为那种人没必要。
This woman is called Yan. In Chinese, I call her Yan Jie, Sister Yan.Sister Yan is also an immigrant from a remote village in Guizhou because of the relocation policy.
我到时候帮你把这个菜弄一下，洗一下。
不用，我现在这些菜是每天吃的，今天都就这个煮汤，那个炒出来，鹿茸锅。
哦，好贵州啊！
鹿茸锅这个就是昨天的菜，我们就随便吃一点，我们三个人。现在用水焯一下，煮一下。你在网上看到的是吧？
对，它好出名耶。
他以前是个乡村教师，也是搬迁到这边来了才进入这个党。
Before relocating in Tongren, Yan Jie was working in a construction site with a husband in Hainan, while the children went to school in Guizhou. With a government-funded house, the couple no longer had the pressure to buy a home. It made it possible for her to take better care of herself and be with her children.
你看我们这闺蜜，一得空就聚在一起，一得空就聚在一起，你看呢？有说有笑的，还有好多啊！我们也爱跳，真的很爱跳。
In our conversation, it was very evident to me what really backed up her conviction in her strong opinions. Her street food business, selling snacks to locals.
I think the happy life is just using your ability to earn money.就是你能挣100，尽量或者用50，用30，把这个生活质量，只要饿不死，冷不死，知道吧？够温饱就 OK， 就这样。再说自己的生活自己去争取，有趣，知道吧？还感觉自己在这个世界活着很有价值，就像一颗小草在，你在每一个角落都要自己去努力成长，努力去生长。你要是。不勤奋不努力，你在大城市也无法生活，你是一个也在小城市也无法生活，在乡农村一样的不能生活，是吧？你就是一颗金子，你在勤奋的挣钱
再养活自己，知道吧？你在每一个地方你都能生活得活得好好的，可以生活得很好，这就是我的人生观念。
I asked Yan Jie to give me some numbers of how poverty relief works in Tongren.
Our house is 5人的，那5个人就是房子的平方就是100平，一个人20平米，知道吧？后来我们就是把那个旧房拆掉嘛，旧房拆掉就是按旧房跟那个人头补助下来，我们就是2万多块钱嘛，5个人。我们交房的那个钱才1万块钱。后来国家把这些政策搞好了以后，补助下来就是27,500，我们家5个人。我们搬迁过来的这个异地搬迁过来的人，有那个回家自助的那种培训班，有那个定工啊、焊工啊，还有那个养老护理啊，还有那个预保啊，这些都有。他这个听数有10天的、18天的、25天的、30天的、有35天的，这一块我们这个小区每年都要培训。
一年是多少次？
一年3次，他就是每天有贫困餐嘛，还有40块钱的生活补贴，就这样。而且有很多我们都有得过证的，有证件的。
燕姐，你今天赚了多少钱？
赚了200多，将近300块钱吧。
今天是不是生意很好？
对，耶、
这很好。
把钱那边借干。你要这些多，你看先干那轻点儿就去了。
I really, really like Yan's story because she represents something that is deeply rooted in the best of the Chinese culture. The unshakable pragmatism in all phases of life. To work hard to achieve to the best of your abilities, no matter how humble or how difficult it is. That is the side of the Chinese culture I've never had the opportunity or the language to say until that moment. I'm also gonna say something that other China vloggers probably wouldn't be bothered to say. I also chose to represent her story instead of the man because I like her. I like her passion, her strong personality, her fighting spirit. That's just very me. Even though we came from a very different background, I was able to connect with her through her values and learn a side of China that I was never able to consider before. But what about the man? What do I make of him? I don't dismiss his complaints. His problems reflect China's challenge to fight corruptions and upskill the outdated labors in order to help them keep up with China's growth. So let's keep that accountable. But the future of China can only be created by people like Sister Yan. China's journey to greater wealth is not entirely the responsibility of the government, but also a strong culture of optimism and hard work. So is China's effort at poverty alleviation worth celebrating? Yes and no, depending on your perspective on if the glass is half full or half empty. But for me, after getting to know Sister Yan, I'm incredibly optimistic. Right.